I mean, what binds us? What do we all have in common anymore? And I think we have to think about that. I think this is, when I was a kid, even as we had laws that held us apart, there were things that we held dear and that we all had in common. And I think we have to, we always talk about the pluribus unum. What's our unum now? We have the pluribus, what's the unum?
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Dennis Prager Show.
I want to share with you another thing that I was reading in an article in the New York Times of a Pew Research study that was done. And it was it came out with a very remarkable statistic. A third of millennial males think that asking a woman out for a drink is harassment. That's this really, if that is true, I have to say that is something that does bother me. And we're going to talk about that in the male-female hour. Hello, my friends. I'm Dennis Prager. Great to be with you. This is the male-female hour. I believe it's the most honest talk about men and women in the American media at this time. But if it isn't, I salute who is ever tied or even more open than I. It's not a competition. I'm just affirming what I aim to achieve here, and that is real openness and honesty. And I have one agenda and only, well, actually I have two agendas, that men and women understand each other better and that they get along better. And as I tell you each week, I am not a man fan or a woman fan. There are wonderful and awful people of both sexes, and I don't believe that there is a third sex. And that's why this is the male-female hour and not the male-female non-binary hour, which some would like, especially those who've attended graduate school. A piece in the New York Times by a fine writer named Barry Weiss. It's a woman, B-A-R-I, a young woman who writes for the New York Times. It's actually worth reading. And she notes in a recent piece, a very intelligent piece, I might add, and she writes in it, I just lost it, and now I found it. A recent survey by The Economist / YouGov, in other words, it's this group called YouGov, Y-O-U-G-O-V, and The Economist in Britain. They conducted a survey, which I will report to you about in a moment. It was in The Economist, and it was titled Over-Friendly or Sexual Harassment? It depends partly on whom you ask. And it asked men and women of various ages from 18 to 64 plus, in Britain, France, Germany, Sweden, and the United States about certain behaviors. In each, virtually every single case, whatever the behavior, the younger the person, the more they were likely to think, male or female, that it constituted sexual harassment. In other words, to a certain extent, one might say that the younger the person, the more conservative they are in sexual matters, not behavior, but in sexual, in the way they regarded certain sexual behaviors or really speech. In any event, it found that approximately 25% of millennial age American men, I hope you're ready, I want to repeat it, about a quarter of the American men of millennial age think asking someone for a drink is harassment. Did you hear that? Did you get that? Is that clear? I can imagine that you think you heard wrong. Hey, how would you like to go for a drink sometime? A quarter of American men of millennial age think that that is harassment. That means, in effect, that a quarter, if it's accurate, a quarter of American men of millennial age think that asking a woman out is harassment. If asking a woman for a drink is harassment, then asking a woman to a movie is harassment, right? I mean, there's, I don't know any difference. Do you? That is the way people will often ask. That's the way men will often ask a woman out. Would you like to have a drink sometime? That is considered by a quarter of American millennials to be harassment. If that is true, I pity both sexes of the younger generation, if that is true. First of all, it is profoundly emasculating of males. Masculinity is a precious thing, and it is valued by only two sexes, men and women, particularly valued by women. That is, after all, what renders a man desirable for most women, is his masculinity. More than a third of millennial men and women, this time it's women included, say that if a man compliments a woman's looks, it is harassment. Well, I want to congratulate the left on ruining another area of life, if this is true, and it's not published in a conservative magazine. You really look great in that dress. Well, that dress looks great on you. In other words, anything, apparently anything that affirms a male-female difference, anything that celebrates it, certainly, is now forbidden in the eyes of many, many in the younger generation. The banter, the male-female banter that has been so much a part of American and free life generally is now suspect. Now, by the way, there are many who might say good. I think there's a loss here. I do. And for men to be walking around in fear of women is not a good thing. They should be walking around in fear of doing bad things to anybody, men or women, obviously. That I totally support that. And it could be a fine line that makes these distinctions. Nevertheless, it is worth noting. I'll give you some more of the results of this survey here. So let's see. By the way, it's, in the United States, commenting on a woman's attractiveness, the number is very high. It's actually, yes, it's approaching 50%. She says it's a third. Well, maybe I'm looking at a chart, which is not precise. It just has 25, 50, 75, 100. Of course, as you get older, fewer and fewer women think that it is sexual harassment. Now, it may be, the poll may be really, well, no. In fact, no, the poll seems to be accurate. I take that back. I was reading it incorrectly. For example, on asking a woman out for a drink, as you get older, as you get into the 60s and older among Americans, it's zero. You are approaching zero. In other words, no woman thinks that. There's no such thing as no woman, but in other words, statistically, no woman thinks that is a form of sexual harassment, nor does a man. And if it's gone up to 25% of men, then I assume it will only rise as we get more and more anguish about these matters. Then we have, let's see, what's another one? Looking at breasts. 50% of men and women in the millennial age think that that is sexual harassment. So I'm curious, if a woman exposes much of her breasts, is that a form of sexual harassment of men? The question is meant completely honestly. There is nothing cute about it. And, of course, what does looking at mean? Is it prolonged? Oh, it's a serious question. I'm not being cute about this subject. And, again, the older the woman or man, the less they believe that that is a form of sexual harassment. Sean has just volunteered to be one of the subjects of a study on this matter.
That I am.
Now, as it happens, I am in Atlanta, Georgia today, and a young man who, let's see, are you with the mic?
Yes, I am.
Oh, terrific. So introduce yourself, please.
My name is Nick Bean. I work here at Salem, Atlanta.
That you do.
I am 25 years old.
What qualifies as a millennial?
I think it goes up to like 36 or 37 years old is the oldest millennials.
Really? All right. Okay, you're a young millennial, which is even better.
Right.
Well, he walked in, Nick did, during the break and said that he's a new listener to the show and his favorite hour is male-female hour, and he wants to verify that this is correct as a young male in the United States. So I said, come on, I want to put you on the show. By the way, folks who want to call in on these issues, 1-8-PRAGER-776-877-243-7776. And I just want to remind you that what I'm talking about is in The Economist, they published a poll. Approximately 25% of millennial-age American men think that just asking a woman out for a drink is harassment. It's a quarter of them. And more than a third of both men and women of that age say that if a man compliments a woman's looks, it's harassment. Almost nobody in the older generation thought it was harassment, either of them. It's about zero. And it gives you an idea of the changes. I believe that these are changes for the worse, but I may be wrong. But you came in, Nick, and you said it's true. So let's go through that for a moment here. You resonate to these statistics, is that correct?
Yeah, definitely.
So if you meet a woman at work or at a bar or at a museum or I don't know what, you won't say, would you like to go out for a drink?
Well, that's the problem. I have before, and doing so, been kind of given that look and the scoff and then walked away from, kind of a how dare you say that to me. It was just a compliment.
One moment, I need to cry. I want to review that. I'm stunned. I am stunned. I'm not faking it. I am stunned. You were given a dirty look by a woman for saying, would you like to go out for a drink?
Mm-hmm. At my last place of employment.
Were you stunned?
I was. Kind of stood there and looked at her and thought, well, I didn't think that was too forward. I didn't, you know, catcall her or say any slang things. I went up to her and said, hey, you and I have gotten to know each other a little bit lately, and I'd love to go grab a drink with you sometime.
And she gave you a dirty look?
She gave me a dirty look. She kind of turned around and walked away. And I figured maybe, you know, just not interested in me.
But no. Wait. No. That's a separate issue entirely. For every generation since Adam and Eve, or since right after Adam and Eve, they had no choice, that men would either be given a yes or a no. And if the woman would say no, she would say, gee, I'd love to, but I'm seeing somebody, or, you know, I'm just not into it these days, or 100 other excuses that were kind, non-demeaning, but never what an offensive thing it is for you to ask me out. This is new. I want you to understand that I'm older than you. I'm telling you, this is new.
It's all I've ever known.
So the other one, too, so I assume beyond belief, if that's harassment, then complimenting a woman on her looks, I mean, that's like you wouldn't even think of doing that.
No. You just kind of leave it as an unspoken truth. If you're speaking to her, then obviously think she's attractive.
You what? Right. You mean by speaking to her?
Right, right. Just by walking up and engaging with her.
Well, yes and no. I mean, I'm friendly to everybody of both sexes, no matter how they look. And so it's not necessarily. But I understand that your point. But it's still not the issue. The issue is you won't say it.
Correct. And not because I feel that there's something wrong with it, but because I understand generally the way it would be received would be negatively. So I'm just not going to go to that point.
So you at this point in our society's life, you as a 25-year-old male, you feel... I would have to imagine quite unnatural around women.
Yeah, it can get very awkward at times.
Okay. All right, Nick, I may call you back. I appreciate your openness. I don't know how, so let me just ask you, since I assume you want to have a girlfriend, was that fair to say?
I actually currently have a fiancé. This was prior to all of that, obviously.
And how did you get her? Did you say, in a previous age, I might, 40 years ago, I would have asked you out for a drink, but of course I won't now.
Well, I decided to take the chance again, and, that's what you have to do sometimes when you get shot down, even when it does come to find out it's because of some weird offense that shouldn't have been taken. I just had to suck it up and go for it.
I will say this, because it's just my nature to be a fighter. If I got the reaction you did from that woman, I would have said, I'm just curious. I have no problem with your saying no. Why in any guise, in any manifestation on planet Earth, was it wrong for me to ask that? What would she say? You don't know.
Not a clue.
So, once again, you met your fiancé the first time you asked her out. Is that right? Did you ask her out?
No. Oh, yeah. The first time after we met and got to know each other.
Yeah.
Yes. Then I asked her on a date, and she was receiving, and we went on a date, and everything went from there.
Well, I'm happy for you. You don't have to live in this new world, this new Orwellian world. All right, Nick. Thanks a million.
Thanks, Dennis.
You're welcome. So that was perfect. Now I'll take your calls. You see, there's a utopian streak on the left, and they do throw out the baby with the bathwater. We shall return. I've been reading to you from a poll, which I learned of in a New York Times piece by Barry Weiss, a young woman who has thoughtful columns at the New York Times, which is quite rare. At the New York Times, but to her credit, she does. And about a poll, and I checked it at The Economist, and indeed it is there, and it is depressing beyond belief, about millennial men and how they fear to interact in any normal way with women. As you just heard from a wonderful young man, 25 years old, works here at the Atlanta station, the Salem Atlanta station, where I'm broadcasting to you from today. You can't say a quarter of men his age think that you are harassing if you say, would you like to go for a drink? And all the other data show that everything is harassment, that including things that almost no people over 60 think, male or female, is harassment. What we have here is a fascinating thing developing in America. We are having stricter rules than they had when America was religious. there was more openness in a religious America to banter and interplay and so on than there is today. I mean, when you think about, you know, Bob Hope comedy routine, for those of you who are old enough to remember Bob Hope, America's, you know, two or three leading comedians, I guess, in the 60s, 70s, 80s. And, you know, he would have a beautiful woman on stage with him and, you know, make comments about her beauty and her being sexy. And that was in the 50s even. This is a religious America, and people were fine with it, because they knew it's just part of life. What we have today, this is the thing that needs to be understood. There's a utopian streak on the left. Life should have no pain. That is the essence of the left-wing view of life. Life should have no pain. And for a woman, it could be a painful issue. And therefore, let's remove all possibilities of pain with regard to male-female difference, regarding female looks and their significance. Let's just do it. Let's just remove it all. And then I can be a true child and suffer no pain. I think I'm going to take an 82-year-old caller, Ann in Algonquin, Illinois. Hi, Ann.
Yes, good morning, Dennis. I thoroughly love your show. I think the result of the what we are seeing today, the cultural craziness, I'll call it, results from what I think has been an ongoing social engineering project by the radical feminists going back many years, as far as I recall, back to the 70s at least. On the one hand, they want to be considered victims because of these terrible men out there. On the other hand, they want to be equal to men in almost all respects. And I think they've transmitted these, I'll call them their crazy ideas, down to the younger generations. When I was a young adult some years ago, I mean, women of my generation and all the circles I moved in at the time, alumni clubs and the workforce and just every place else, women knew how to deal with men, men knew how to deal with women. And if a woman really suspected that some guy was guilty of sexual harassment, verbal sexual harassment, I mean, she would just find a way to tell him to get lost. And there was not all this...
So you're saying that women of your generation at their age were much stronger?
Very definitely. They had definite values. They knew how to act and react in social situations. And I think it was wonderful for women that I knew of. I had a wonderful marriage of 58 years, had a wonderful life as a young adult.
Well, you didn't walk around. All right, I got to take a break. You didn't walk around as a victim. That disqualifies you from modern feminism. All right, we shall return. Well, everybody, welcome back, or welcome to the Dennis Prager Show, Male Female Hour, every Wednesday, the second hour of my program. The data are out in a poll published in The Economist, cited by Barry Weiss in the New York Times, about millennial men. A quarter of them believe that just saying, "Would you like to have a drink?" is considered harassment and other inhibitions on normal speech interplay between the genders. All right, let's go to some more of your calls here. And too bad. It's amazing how often that happens. John in Brooklyn just hung up as I was about to take his call. All right, Heidi in Chicago. Hi, Heidi.
Hi, Dennis. Thanks for taking my call. I just want to say I think you're personally responsible for raising my IQ level. By listening to you every day.
I'm very touched. That's a sweet compliment. I don't think I've raised your IQ.
I haven't actually checked my IQ level.
No, I don't think I have. What I think I've done if I've done anything, is to help you think more clearly, and you identify that with intelligence.
Yes. I'm going to go with that.
Okay. Anyway, go ahead.
All right. So I just wanted to comment. Every week when I go to the grocery store, I go the same day, and there are certain guys that work in the produce department and the meat department that always enjoy seeing me, and they usually comment about my looks. They say something. One even said if he was 30 years younger and I wasn't married, he would love to be with me. So, and then they, you know, comment on how nice I look, and but I've never been offended. I've never looked at it in a bad way. I take it as a compliment, and I rather enjoy it. I enjoy going to the grocery store and knowing that I'm going to see them and talk with them, because we'll sit and we'll chat for 5-10 minutes about life. I enjoy, I know it brings a smile to their face when they see me. It brings a smile to my face to go see them.
Well, you have a real, well, you have a, you've got a number of problems. It's clear. One is you're a happy person, and that immediately disqualifies you from being a feminist. And I mean that literally. I don't think that happy feminists live. They don't exist. There aren't happy leftists. You see life and you embrace it. You don't fear it. They live in fear.
Yes.
And you don't fear men. The average man is not going to hurt you. The average man is a good guy. The average man has sexual thoughts. You are at peace with men. That disqualifies you from seeing it all as harassment. Well, you're a joy. Where were you, in Chicago? When do you show up at that grocery store? I'll try to meet you.
I show up every Monday and Friday in the morning.
I live in L.A. It'll be a little hard. But the truth is, if I'm ever in Chicago, you have to come over and say hello.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much. It's you are watching your society being ruined by the left, my dear fellow Americans. And they're so intimidating to the most people that they don't say anything. Next hour, I'll give you another example of what is happening. How industry and divisions of work in our society are being ruined in the name of diversity. Excellence is being destroyed. What matters is diversity, not excellence. Why are there no... anyway, we'll talk about it next hour. Okay, Houston, Jeff. Hello, Jeff. Dennis Prager.
Dennis, I am so glad to say hello to you. You've shaped my life. I've been listening for 17 years. You've given me the definition of wisdom, and I hope in heaven one day we can be neighbors and sit on the front porch and smoke cigars somewhere.
They are definitely smoking cigars in heaven. I'm with you.
Great. So a couple of years ago, I couldn't believe my ears what was being taught by a pastor at a non-denominational church that I used to go to. Basically, adultery had been redefined to say that any man looking at any woman anytime is now a sin.
Well, they have the excuse of citing Jesus in Matthew, that a man who looks after another woman with lust is as if he has committed adultery in his heart. But, of course, it's important to note that Jesus said in his heart. Jesus was too Jewish and too smart to have equated a feeling with an action. So I just want to make that point, because they would claim scriptural basis as Christians.
Of course, but it is talking about adultery, which had never been... no examples had been given formally anywhere in the Bible that adultery was something that happened out of marriage. And if you continue on with what Jesus was saying, he said, "Pluck out your eye and even cut off your hand." So So if it was, in that case, you could apply that to marriage as well. It's like, okay, it's a sin to look at your own wife, to look at her and to touch her.
Well, there are people who argue that it's an interesting question. Can you lust after your own wife? I mean, I have to believe that there is no religious person of any faith who would say no, you can't. I mean, God has blessed the marriage where the man does lust after his wife. You should you'd be interested. I gave a speech at Yeshiva University a couple of months ago. It's on YouTube. And a young woman got up and she said she never wants to be regarded as a sex object by her husband. And I told her that's too bad, because she'll probably have a happier marriage if he does. That if he never sees her as a sex object, I don't think they'll be as happily married. We live in a very silly age. The left's totalitarian inhibiting of young men is the subject of this male-female hour. We should put the poll up, reported in the New York Times. The entire poll is available at The Economist. I'll get it up at DennisPrager.com. Quarter of men of millennial age think that it's harassment if you ask a woman out for a drink. The reshaping of life by the left, because they're deeply unhappy human beings and blame life and nature for their unhappiness. They don't struggle with themselves. They struggle with a sexist society, a racist society. That is what animates leftists. They don't look within. They don't even acknowledge that life has inherent tension, inherent pain. They will solve it all if they just pass another law, if they just have another movement and another march with more women dressed as vaginas. Oh, this was this John in Brooklyn. He cracks me up. He calls and then hangs up. John, you shouldn't take up a line like that. Okay, we'll go to a different call. Megan in Chicago. Hello, Megan. Dennis Prager.
Hi, Dennis. How are you?
I'm well, thank you.
Well, let me preface this with saying I'm not a feminist, and I am definitely not a liberal, maybe because I'm happy. You can tell that already. But I kind of take this at a different angle. First time I've ever called in, but felt compelled just in my industry that I work in. And
what's your industry?
I'm
sorry.
I work in healthcare.
Okay.
Healthcare and higher education. So I work in a critical care as a nurse, and I have for 15 years, and then I also am adjunct faculty at a university and a community college. So I kind of take a couple of different angles as a woman, as a nurse, as a teacher, in regards to professionalism and what's tolerated in the workplace environment. So some of the things, the items that you were saying, staring at someone's breast, or the opposite, staring at a man's genitalia, if we're going to talk about, in one way, or, asking someone out for a drink. Excuse
who stares
me?
At men's genitalia, other
exactly.
than gay men?
So it's kind of a double standard.
There's no,
we only ask.
Exactly. I wish we had.
Nobody's there. Nobody.
We need more time. I really mean it. You'll be first or second on Friday. Men and women are so different that there's just not a parallel here. And that's what part of the problem is. All right, we continue on the Dennis Prager Show. And I hope this was valuable. Female Uber drivers earn less than male Uber drivers. Did you know that? This just came out. Pretty important because of the fraudulent data about women, the gap between men and women in wages. And we have a great video on that at Prager University, 5-minute video, as all our videos are. And it just shows statistically how this is nonsense, because it has nothing to do where it is true. It has nothing to do with discrimination. Women don't earn less per hour based on the same work and so on. They just generally work fewer hours or in a different field. Now, it is not possible to have discrimination with regard to Uber drivers. I have ordered dozens of them, and they show up. Sometimes it's a female, usually it's a male. They get the fee. The fare is not based on them. It has nothing to do with the driver. It has everything to do with the type of vehicle and the hours in which you are riding. Because they fluctuate, busier hours, higher demand, you pay a higher price. And when there's less demand, you pay a lower price. It has zero to do with the sex of the driver, correct? We can all agree with that. So why is it that men who drive for Uber earn roughly 7% more per hour than women? Okay, the answer is that the men tend to work more hours and they, whatever other factor plays a role in how much you earn as an Uber driver. The time of day that you will drive, if you, the women may be home during the rush hours more than men are, there may be any number of reasons, but it can't be sexual discrimination. Anyway, we'll talk about that. I just wanted to bring that. That just came in, and I wanted to share that with you. In the meantime, on the subject of this whole subject of discrimination against women, Heather McDonald, the great Heather McDonald, I might add, whose courage is only matched by her intellect, writes in that phenomenal journal, City Journal, dated yesterday, February 6th, if the Me Too movement only reduces sexual predation in the workplace, it will have been a force for good. It most likely will result, however, will be to unleash a torrent of new gender and race quotas throughout the economy and culture on the theory that disparities in representation and employment are due to harassment and bias. Hollywood and the media are already showing the effect. It's no coincidence that the Today Show now has two female anchors. The Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences has pledged to double its female and minority members by 2020. Actress Natalie Portman's sneer in presenting the Best Director Prize at the recent Golden Globe Movie Awards, and here are the all-male nominees, will become the standard response to any perceived lack of diversity in entertainment. The Wall Street Journal's pop music critic, Jim Fusilli, for example, groused that females were underrepresented among Grammy Award winners, among Grammy Award nominees. No groups led by women are among the nominees in the Best Contemporary Instrumental, Best Jazz Instrumental, Best Large Jazz Ensemble, and Best Contemporary Christian Music Album categories. There is no Grammy category comprised entirely of women, he complained. Six female music industry executives then complained to the Recording Academy's Board of Trustees that the Recording Academy's leadership suffered from, quote, inclusion issues across all demographics. In response, management has penitently promised to overcome the, quote, unconscious biases that impede female advancement, unquote, in the music industry. The National Hispanic Media Coalition is planning to protest at the Academy Awards because of the paucity of Hispanic Oscar nominations. Even before the Hispanic protest, Hollywood execs were experiencing quota fatigue, given the pressure from feminists, LGBTQ, and disability activists to hire by identity category. Bean counting won't be limited to Hollywood. Corporate diversity trainers already sense a windfall from Me Too. Hashtag Me Too. Requests from organizations wanting to, quote, explore further the intersection of power with diversity dimensions and inclusion have recently increased, according to a client success manager at a major diversity consulting firm. Corporate boardrooms, executive suites, and management structures will be scoured for gender and race imbalances. The advocacy group 50-50 by 2020 which argues for equal male and female representation in business, has recently received several new commitments from organizations pledging to achieve gender parity by the year 2020. 2 months before the explosion of hashtag MeToo, New York Mayor Bill de Blasio anticipated the coming pressures on museum management. The city's culture funding would henceforth be contingent on the diversity of an arts organization's employees and board members, he announced. Is that clear? New York will now give money to museums based on the diversity of their employees and board members. The New York Times helpfully pointed out that the Metropolitan Museum of Art, Carnegie Hall, and the American Museum of Natural History are led, quote, largely by white male executives and power brokers from Wall Street, real estate, and other industries. I continue. Have those white male executives preserved the cultural patrimony bestowed by visionary collectors of the past? Did those white male executives generously donate millions of dollars to the institutions they serve? Who cares? The Times put a picture of conductor Andres Nelson's, a white man, performing at Carnegie Hall on the front page as a damning illustration of the problem. What hangs on the walls of art museums and galleries is an equally inviting bean-counting target. In a sample of nearly 70 institutions analyzed by the art newspaper, that's what the name of it is, art newspaper, females had solo shows only 27% of the time. Female artists have graced the cover of Art Forum only 18% of the time. This is about to change. The art world is misogynist, Art Forum's new editor-in-chief David Velasco told the Los Angeles Times. Art history is misogynist. Also racist, classist, transphobic, ableist, homophobic. That's something, art history is homophobic. I will not accept this. And then my favorite line shows the man has gone to graduate school. Intersectional feminism is an ethics near and dear to so many on our staff. Yes, my friends, it is not merely feminism. It is intersectional feminism. The history of art that Velasco so derides has produced crushing beauty and profound insight into human nature. That is irrelevant to the coming crusade. That is correct. Heather McDonald is right. The left has no interest in excellence. It has an interest in race, gender, and class. So, to you millennials and younger, you have a very dismal future thanks to what the left is doing to our society. I'm sorry. I fought it. I'm Dennis Prager. We continue. I have been reading to you from Heather McDonald, the great Heather McDonald. I don't use the word lightly or often. In her piece yesterday in the City Journal, which is a great magazine. And it is about the now massive push in all of these areas in the arts and business to have everything 50-50. And that will include funding if you don't have more women on your board at your museum and among the artists that your museum whose works you display, you won't get money from the New York City government. She writes, it was already difficult 2 years ago to land a U.S. conducting position for a universally esteemed white male conductor. Now it would be nearly impossible. Music critic Alex Ross triggered outrage against the Chicago Symphony Orchestra and the Philadelphia Orchestra last week when he tweeted that they had programmed no female composers in their 2018-2019 seasons. Never mind that over most of music history, the greatest composers have been male. At a time of diminishing classical music audiences, it is reckless to wield identity politics against our most important and precious musical institutions. But they don't care. The left wrecks, you understand. The left loves to wreck. It's exciting, and it brings about change, and change is in and of itself good. As she points out, as I do too, as a music lover, part-time conductor myself, I know that having more female composers represented in concerts is not going to create a greater demand for seats at concerts. But it doesn't matter. They are willing to see the Chicago Symphony or Philadelphia Orchestra lose money and perhaps go bankrupt than not have more female composers represented. I'll have more from that, but I want to go to your calls. Nelson in Glendale, California. Hi, Nelson.
Hey, Dennis. You kind of go a little bit off topic a little bit for why I called initially. I mean, you did on the top of your hour, you did say...
No, I want you to talk about... I took your call because I want to talk about it. It's totally related. It's not off the topic at all. So go ahead.
Sure. Well, I tell you, as an Uber driver, my wife tried to do Uber. She couldn't do the hours that I did. And we were on a level playing field. And I tell you, I make more than I would at a job. So thank God for Uber. It's a great hustle. And I know you promoted on your show. Giving it a plug, and it's great. Thank you for that. But I tell you this, as an Uber driver here in Los Angeles, I pick up a lot of people, a lot of millennials that are on the left, a lot of Trump haters. And I think in the last year, they're starting to see a little bit of the light. So I got to tell you, Dennis, there is some hope. There is some hope in this country. It's going to start turning because they're not happy. They're not happy where this is going. On your male-female hour last hour, I picked up a young gal. She had to be in her late 20s, new baby. She agreed with everything that was said in the last hour. Her generation is just whacked out of their minds. They're nuts. And she's recognizing that. And I think, and I'm starting to see, because I pick up a lot, I pick up about 120 people in Los Angeles County. And I think it's going to start turning our...
I hope so. The message has to be to young people, the left is ruining your future, period. They're unhappy, and they're going to make your future and you unhappy. If you follow the left, America and you are in for a terrible time. I just want to make something clear. You and your wife are Uber drivers. You made more in part because you would drive at the hours where the rates were higher, correct?
That's absolutely right.
Okay, that's it. I just want to make that clear to everybody. The left lies in almost every arena, and they lie about the wage gap because they don't tell you why there is one. They will cite Uber. Look, even Uber drivers. But it's not possible that there is discrimination against women Uber drivers because you pay the exact same fare no matter who your driver is. But different hours demand different rates, and as any one of you has used Uber or Lyft knows. Okay. All right. Thank you, Nelson. And let's go to, Ben in my city, Atlanta. Hi, Ben.
How you doing? Okay, so I'm trying to get this straight in my head. So to prove they're not being biased by hiring by color, gender, or race, I'm going to hire based on color, gender, or race.
That is correct.
Okay.
You got it right. Not only that, just remember that this. I was taught this by my left-wing instructors. There is no such thing as black racism. There is only white racism. They actually say that. That is a doctrine.
No, it makes perfect sense if you don't think.
That's right, or that's correct, and they don't. It'll be very interesting and I hate using that word because it doesn't tell you much, the word interesting, but at least in these contexts, but it will be interesting to see, to live long enough to see what happens with this millennial generation. Will they awaken to the wreckage given to them by the left, that they have given them a BA that is worthless because they learned so little, that they have been taught to fear whites and males and heterosexuals, and to think not in terms of excellence, but in terms of group. Everything that leftists taught them stinks. Will they know it? I think they will. The only question is how many lives will have been ruined by the left by the time they awaken. See, for example, people always say, and I'm never at peace with this, say, well, in the long term, the good win. Yeah, in the long term, the good win. But in the term prior to the really long term, the bad guys do win. The number of lives ruined by the left will be very, very large and very, very long period of time. And there's no guarantee that America will recover from the damage done to all of its great institutions. Not much more to know that whatever the left touches, it ruins. And my daily announcement, not liberals. Liberals don't fight the left because they're wimps, but they're not leftists. You're listening to The Dennis Prager Show. Devastating piece about the world we're entering with all this diversity, totalitarianism. If you don't know that the left is totalitarian in its essence, then you don't know the left. Not liberals are not totalitarian. That's why liberals should be anti-left, like some are. Some are. Alan Dershowitz is the best-known liberal who's anti-left and believes that the left is a much greater threat to liberalism than the right is, because that's true. Conservatives never threaten the liberals. Of course not. We see things differently, but we don't threaten, because we want a liberal and open society, but not the left, anywhere on earth, anywhere in its history. You should be ashamed of yourself if you're on the left. You don't have to be ashamed of yourself if you're a liberal. You should be ashamed of yourself if you don't fight the left. What is happening now in the United States with regard to everywhere, just about everywhere, you have to have 50-50 male, female, and where are your Hispanics, and where are your blacks, and where are your LGBTQ? I'm reading you, in every area of life in America, Heather McDonald writes about. That's going to be something. More women composers. We have to have more women composers represented on symphony concerts or classical concerts. Yeah, but the number of great women composers is very, very small. So it's like asking, why don't we have more whites in the NBA? Because blacks tend to do better. That's why. The economics field has been hit with the Me Too diversity pressures. A panel at the annual American Economic Association meeting this January charged that gender discrimination was pervasive in economics. An argument that fit into the, quote, larger national examination of bias and abuse toward women in the workforce, unquote. The New York Times reminded readers. That's something. There's a national examination of bias and abuse toward women in the workforce. If females are underrepresented on economics faculties, it is because of such insurmountable barriers as the percentage of male economists cited in leading college textbooks, 90%. Were there comparable female economists who could have been cited for the relevant proposition instead? Unlikely, but in any case, we don't need to know. She goes and points out that in economics these days, which I think is a bad idea, but it is what it is, there's a lot more emphasis on math, and men score much higher on SATs in math than women do. I presume that that is a function of sexism. This February, a panel at the American Association for the Advancement of Science's annual meeting will address, quote, the cultural and institutional practices, unquote, that suppress female and underrepresented minority voices in STEM fields, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. It is curious that the Me Too movement is concerned only with gender representation in particular occupational categories. This is a great point by Heather McDonald. For instance, most refrigeration installers and mechanics are men. Yet there was little outcry about getting more girls into vocational training for these jobs. Similarly, virtually all workers in the carting, moving, trucking, and mining industries are males. But female underrepresentation in these high-injury, high-fatality occupations have not sparked celebrity outrage. Finally, listen to this. I told you, the more you go to college, the more foolish, the stupider you become. Here's a little proof. Pew Research Center poll on workplace equity is worth noting. The perception of bias is directly proportional to the number of years the perceiver has spent in an American university. That's right. When I meet young people who are doing fine in life and never went to college, I salute them. You're listening to the Dennis Prager Show. Well, hello, everybody. Powerful point by Heather McDonald, isn't it? You never hear about the lack of representation of women in trucking or in air conditioning installation. Because they're not sexy like museum curators. Well, society is being changed by the left because they live for change. They live to perceive injustice. It's great to feel that there's somebody victimizing you. And when you don't fight real evil, you fight make-believe evils. These are all things I've been saying my whole life about the left. And they continue to this day. Eventually, there'll be a backlash, but a lot of lives will have been wasted in the meantime. A lot of everything, every institution of excellence will have been essentially destroyed or deeply damaged, and they'll have to be recreated again. We're entering a dark age, thanks to the left. Dark morally, dark intellectually, dark artistically, dark economically. That is what they will usher in. Okay, that's right. As Paul is entirely right. The Uber thing is, he's mentioning, I'm looking at the subject of his call. Men drive faster, too. That's probably one reason that they make more. But I'd like you to ask anybody who believes that it's discrimination that causes women to earn less money, ask them how it is that Uber women drivers earn less money than Uber men drivers. That's a great test of the intellectual honesty of the fool who believes the propaganda that they got in college. Because college makes you a fool if you believe what you've been told. You can escape. College is not a fool if you know how to distinguish truth from fiction. Jody in Woodstock, Georgia. Hi, Jody. Dennis Prager.
Hi, Dennis. I just wanted to talk to you actually about my experience. I am a stay-at-home mom, dream come true. But one of the reasons why it has been such a long wait for this dream to come true is because, as a woman, first of all, I did make more than my husband. So there's really not the discrimination they talk about. I definitely made more than him, which then put pressure on our family for me to be the one continuing to work. So in the future, if they put these quotas in that they're talking about, and then I'm sure that they will continue to do this, it actually will put more pressure on us women who want to stay home and work, because financially we'll have to, because our husbands, who are well deserving of promotions and opportunities, and
what a great point.
Pay,
that's right.
Overlooked.
What a great point. Well, which will only bring the left happiness anyway. The thought of a nuclear family with the woman staying home to make the home is a nightmare vision to the left.
It is, and I feel like it's even a plot. You know, they really want to break the family up. They want to incentivize women with money to get out there and
that's
work
right.
rather than take care of that, their
and
they
right.
want more control.
That's the reason. That's the reason they're not complaining about the disproportionate number of men who install refrigerators. That's exactly right. You made a beautiful choice, Jody. God bless you. Your marriage and your children will thank you. Claus in Burbank, California. Dennis Prager, hi.
Hey, Dennis, my friend, my buddy. Thank you for taking my call. Well, I was on my way to attend the engineering college at CSUN, and I was reminded of my prior experience at Pasadena City College that the left has really infiltrated everything, everything from technology to engineering to science, because they bring the whole, you know, global warming this and climate change that and equality this and gender neutrality that. So I don't know where to go from here.
You have to fight. I it's a very tough call. I would not want to be your age today in the West generally and in America specifically. They're truly doing whatever they can on the left to hurt your life. It's as simple as that. You need to know that. You do know that. You need to let others know that. The left is ruining our lives, my fellow millennials. I had no interest in conservative or anything like that. I'm not political. I'm just telling you, folks. We live in a damn good country. We're damn lucky to be here.